glad you got him. Don't let him talk for you. He'd never run out of employment. he said, I told my hawks over here at Homer Roy down here, what we call Triple A, what it is. I want you to help me drive them over there. I'll tell you what the way I felt. I said, I wouldn't drive them hogs over there for every one of them. What can I stand up? I got me an old quilt. The door here, people are all safe. I laid on that quilt for 2 or 3 days before I come to. Ready. And that's been the last drink of whiskey I took. I thought it was that fun. Now, I'll tell you what, that stuff is good, but I tried it. I tried it.
You would have tried maybe twice so much.
Oh, I tell you, I didn't get sick. But I drunk 2 or 3 days of it.
Corn moonshine.
I advise to anybody not drink that stuff. No good for nothing. It won't cure nothing. It won't make you no friend. It won't make you any smarter. These guys come here better traffic. They'll drive up here. You want to go with us? We're going down the bridge to the better traffic. Yeah, I'll go with you. Get down there and get out of here. You want a little nip of this? No. Well, that's pretty good traffic. Better take a little nip. No. And then go to somewhere and play a fiddle a little bit. Somebody say, let's go out and take a little nip. I said, you can nip it if you want to. I went to say one time, we had off the kitchen, you know, and that was along about 10 o'clock. I said, Greg and I'd better go home. No, she said, not late yet. I said, well, I said, just how long do you want me to stay in? She said, all the time. That helped.
All the time.
All the time, she said. I could walk to the good. I'd get out and cut wood, this little painter. They'd been enough pasture my way sure this winter to win it 100 head of cattle. Them fields just full grass. Well, you go out to the cattle, there's no fence. The creek knocked the fence all out, just all rolled and fell down. That mail boy comes here. He comes in, got his type of bag. He's here the other day. He said, I'd sure like to move that field up to my place. That's why I turned the cattle on. I said, you can just come down here and turn my little wife here. I said, the Lord picked off it had on his. I thought, he'd be hard to do. Well, that stuff's up that high and just matted. Now, you take a stick from that, you're not cut that. I don't believe anybody cut that. That grows up in there and I'd be a little wet underneath there. One machine won't cut it. Thank you, God.
You gonna play for us?
I've already talked it all out.
Oh, no.
I don't know whether I could or not.
I don't think you've ever had stage fright.
You know, nothing's going to scare me. Not anything. No, I'm not afraid of nothing. You know, I'll tell you one chapter sometime. Hey, I had my travel bar down on my little place on the highway. That guy, Timo, what is his name? That preacher's son. About that rebel mentor anymore.
Craig.
Yeah. I'll tell you what happened. I was around here coming up on the computer. He came down here one day and come up there and said, I'm a fourth brother. He said, you own that gravel bar down there the highway? And I said, yes, we do. He said, I'd like to set my gravel plant down there. I said, honey, said in there. He said, tomorrow. I said, all right. I said, just go ahead down there. And he said, I'll tell you what I'll do. He said, I'll pay you every weekend for what I haul out. I said, all right. Go ahead and set it down there. Well, I wasn't down there. 2 miles down there. The highway wasn't bad. I never went down there at night. I mean, it went on 5 months. He hauled out of there 5 months and never paid me a dime. So Johnny, he went down there one morning, there's two white oak trees down there. The entrance into this gravel or into the pasture, into the bottom field or whatever. Johnny put his truck in there. Here come Riley down there, the truck driver, to get a little gravel. Johnny told him no, he wasn't going in there another time, said you're leaving the gate open, let my cattle out. Said you're not going in there another time. Said you never paid that nothing no how. Well, I guess I had quite a racket. I didn't hear that part yet. Anyway, pretty soon Donnie drove up right there at that tree and flowers. Got out, he told me about the thing, what happened in there and so on. I said, wait till I get my hat. I said, I'm going to reach it. I wasn't excited. Donnie had his 30-30 stuck on his seat in his truck. As Riley told him, I meant many kills, and I said, you've got to have to kill another. So I went down there, got down there, and Lord Ruddy called the sheriff. Got down there at the gate again on the highway there. And the sheriff was sitting there, and this truck driver, he was there, Riley, and he complained because he couldn't get gravel right up, you know. And so the sheriff said to me, he said, you own this land? And I said, I do. And he looked at this Riley and said, this man wants this man to you stay out much of this one. He said, that's what the government is. Anyway, sure. Well, I know it's good. Run him off. They won't pay nothing, I don't guess. He got over in there about Bramstutter. He got home over in there on Wolf Creek somewhere. He never would pay for nothing. They run him off. Karen, where's that pie you were going to break in?
I told him on the way up here, you probably asked me.
You got what?
I said, I told Danny on the way up here, you probably asked me where that pie was.
Now you see, I can remember things. Oh, I just can't get that pie. She baked me pie for Christmas. Boy, one of them great big things. And an apple pie. Honey, I don't know whether I can play anything. Too old to play the fiddle or do anything.
Well, oh, now I don't believe that.
Too crippled up.
Your hands work just fine. Your hands work just fine.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'll tell you. I'm not run down, but I don't want to get run down. But you know, I can go over to Ale over there here, I'm talking again. I can go over there to Ale and everybody knows me, and that's just can't get run me here and stuff.
Tell Regina about the time you met Grandmommy.
Oh, I don't know what I don't think she's. You want me to tell you about the first time I seen her? I didn't know there was this girl. Now, I'll tell you what. I knew her sister. I'd seen her sister around, but I didn't know about this little freckle face. That little pretty one, I didn't know anything about her. You want me to tell that?
Yeah.
All right. I was plowing over there on that mother's home tin. The turn plow, and I heard that Norman, you seen him. He was about a year or two old, and he could out cry every four kids I ever heard. It just, I was up on top of the hill, it's like that, and they lived right down the foot of the hill. And I heard him crying down there. I never heard kids crying, them old horses never heard. They just wave their heads and listen, you know. So I plowed them. Anyway, went down there that evening, you know, and out come over, you know.
I said, "Chop, I'm coming on by. I'm not going to get in here and turkey. You know, got it just a step, you know. Packed up and freckled on this morning. I thought, God, just where did that come from?"
Just come out there. We all three got in that buggy, you know. He got up and he was a fiddle up with the organ. Then she just got up and said, "I didn't think he was." Come on back, old devil. Come on back with me. Got out. They opened that old gate, threw them into the house. I turned the team around. I'm crying. He was going by and hollering. Right on that. And then single trees stuck way out like this. One of them caught on the bush and broke the end of it off. Of course, I'm not getting it. I said, "Well, I thought I was going to run." And I changed girls. And you know what happened then? Out come the mom. Golly, she came out and she had a stick about 11 memories. Yeah, she looked. When I was down waiting, she said, "Just which way you come in?" I said, "Better go cut that way to see why." I'd ride that good horse. But there wasn't one part of that horse. You could see that thing through the timber, that gray horse, a mile. Her mother'd run out and see, she'd just go to bed while her mother'd run out and see if I was with her coming back from that great home. Her mother was up. She'd get in all the trouble she'd been. You lads want to see my saddle, I'll let you look at the saddle.
It's pretty. It's in the back here, isn't it? It's pretty. Have you ever seen it?
You don't want to get in there, Buzz. There's some awful mess in there, man. If you won't get in there, it's hanging out the fairway. It's all right here. Yeah. You going in the right hole? Needs a lot of repair. The seat part's good. The hip's good. And I rode that. So one of them seal serves. My foot went right through the board out.
Where'd that saddle come from?
Los Angeles, California. 1950. There was an old cowboy come back here and rode a lot of bucking horses with him back here. Father passed away, and Pete Hill and Uncle Joe Elton died. And he came back not too many years ago. And he asked me, he said, "Have you still got that saddle?" I said, "Yeah, I'm glad," but I said, "It's old and the leather falls off." Well, he said, "I'd give $500 for it anyway, if it ain't got a piece of leather on it, leather to cover it." But to me, that's the best saddle I ever rode. It rides good. And if you can ride, it takes a pretty good horse to get you out of that thing.
Oh, yeah?
Well, Karen, I don't believe I'd better pay you this ring that size.
That's all
right.
When
will I qualify for that tie?
As soon as I get time to make it for you.
Can I wait till now? I'll get a side hunter for you.
It'll probably be before Christmas. But.
Well, maybe I'd better play. I've got so many of these junker fiddles around. I've got some good fiddles, but these junker fiddles, I keep them to play on. I'll tell you the reason I do. Trade on. Play on real good.
Which one's that old one? Is this that old one?
You played on a couple last time we was down, and there's a world difference on that old one you play from the other ones.
Yeah. I've got a 3/4 size there, and I've got that other fist size there, and I've got one up in that case and hit the hawk. I guess it's worse.
Is that the one that used to sit on the bar of the saloon?
No. No, it's in there. It belongs to Floyd Blankenship. That's good. It's here. But it was one that didn't leave before he was grown. Because he was over there at that saloon with Ava. And he said that fiddle, they had showcases and they had candy, you know, cigars and stuff, and showcases got that out right away. He said that fiddle was laying on that showcase for the drums play on. They come in and told whiskey for the drum play. He said they'd come in there and play on that fiddle. Dad said he wasn't grown, so he went in there and played on the fiddle. Finally then after that, why, that's great grandfather, Donnie Birthday, right up here. So he went over there and borrowed this fiddle. Everybody liked it. It was a hot, hot officer. Corn steamer. Never seen one like it before. But anyway, he brought it over here, and the old man, you know, which is please don't belong to the fiddle. They knew it, they thought he wanted to get that thing to take it even a little. I might think he did too. But anyway, he brought it over here, this old Donnie Birthday. Great grandfather. But anyway, the old man got sick. And he told him that he wanted him when he paid to go die, that he wanted him to bury his fiddle with him. But this old Walt husband married one of Donnie Burst's daughter, Cynthia Ann. I seen her anyway. But of course, place of putting a fiddle in a cabin of the old man. He took him home with him. He lived over on Fox Creek or somewhere. He took his fiddle home with him. But it went on for years and years. After a while, he sold it to somebody. I don't know. It was Mickey Harv Robbins had it directly. Bob got it. And directly that left around run the post office, he got it. Dad, he kept talking about it. Said he liked to have that. Went on. The cousin of mine got his Bertie James. He lived pretty now. We lived up there in the house. Dad said one day, he said, if you can get me a horse, he said, I'll go to Brush Knob and see if I can buy that thing. Bertie James got it. So Aunt Abby lived over there, and Abby John, she was mother's sister, so he was several miles from Brush Knob. Dad, he goes over there and he stayed all night with Aunt Abby. Next morning, he went and went to this fiddle, bought it, and brought it back. We lived up that old house and had the neck on that. So I asked him up, it's been here ever since. Of course, that old man wasn't very that good. If he had regulated the old Dolly that had $100 bill and told him to marry, he wouldn't have drank that old cup, all something to him.
How old is he?
He's
18,
probably. When that fiddle was made?
17, 21, I think. Now, that thing's worth a lot of money. Fell out more to tell about. But somebody come here and breaking the house. I locked the house, but they didn't want to. But they'll pop the steel up there.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. It's a horn steel, and it's the only one I ever seen. It's not too good a looking fiddle. It's all right. Lord, I don't reckon Dad gave it to him when he got saved. He gave it to him. Then one of them grams, great grams, that old man, come here and tried to buy it from Dad. And that's been years ago. Dad was too late that I gave it to him. In his house. I don't know whether I'd order a plate for you and wait on that pie. Or if you'd had that pie, I'd already been playing. Yeah. Well, I'll get over there. And you want to get. Now, that'll scare me. I'll just trim on shade.
Oh, no.
I think that bothers. You know, I played up there at Seymour. Were you up there when they had me on TV?
I guess so.
I get letters from all over the United States. Anyway,
about 8 miles out of it.
East, right, yeah, east.
Down this way toward Mansfield?
Yeah, I don't live too far from Mansfield. I just live about, it's really about 7 miles from Mansfield, too. I'm just right in the middle of it, really. Not too far at all.
Yeah. You don't live too far then. That's Scotty's lumber yard.
No, huh? No.
Scotty. I'm going to go up there, buy some cans.
Her dad owns a runs a lumber yard.
Who does?
My dad.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I got to buy this channel. I'm crazy. Back. Scotty's lumber yard. He's I wanted to cover that schoolhouse before my leg went the whole way. I down Johnny's and I said, I want to cover that schoolhouse if I had a ladder. He's got one of the best ladders. You know business up on there, so we didn't go get into the ladder, and I didn't. But I'd had no money. This old port was leaking here, buddy, too, boy. Leaking down there on the concrete. Not out there, but so well, can't put up the glass. So I had some shingles down there at the tool house, and I got to the tractor. And I went around with me to start with, and she was upstairs and went out this way to make it all. Head don't leave now. I did, I thought that was pretty bad. But went out and raised the winter up here. I didn't jump through it. I went out on the porch and made it work. Well, carrying the promise of that pie.
Which one do you want?
I better get over on that stool.
You want to get over here?
Oh, that's all I said right there. You won't bother me. So I may have to stop and talk. Hell, boy, I can't hardly go my legs still. One of them, especially. Yeah, it's all right. I don't turn that thing on until I see what this plan is. This is my baby pen.
Thank you.
scared now. Yeah, that's pretty good little film. I don't mind.
It sure is a little thing.
Thing on. Thank you. Yeah. You guys dance, get up here in this knob or all.
I can't move that fast.
Hey, I can slow down. Turn this down a little. I did go over and play that dance hall. Is that getting my talking?
Probably.
Well, anyway.
Have you ever told Regina what you always tell me when I come up here? About the butterfly.
You want me to tell her?
Yeah, tell her.
I'll tell you, dear. You know, my granddad, he is a choir fiddler, you know. He's talking about these good-looking girls like you two, I suppose. But anyway, he said, now I'll tell you what, he said, he's sitting up there in the corner house scraping on accent. He said, a good-looking girl is just a lot like a butterfly. I said, a girl like a butterfly? Yeah, I said, they sure are. I said, they're just a lot like a butterfly. I said, a butterfly light on all the pretty flowers, fly around, then light in the cow pie. That's what he said. Then, and he is when he had the great protection. Well, I think about what he said about that. Now, there'll be some of the prettiest girls in the world that take up some sorry thing. And he'll just stay drunk, and he'll lay in the beer gun, and he won't provide for his family or nothing. And she'll get in the can, you know, in jail, and that woman, or a lot of them, prettiest girls in the world, maybe the little baby in the morning, another two at the house, and she'll go and just stand and try to talk to that thing. Finally, she'll get him out, take him home where they'll get sorry for her, you know, the jailer will. And he'll do the same thing for over 3 years. I don't see how they can do that. I was up in Glean, Missouri years and years ago, and there's a woman there, and they had her husband in a little old jail, a little old block building in the winter, too high for her to stand on the ground, and she brought her an old stool chair or something, and she set that tail down, and she talked to him through the bars up there. She was up by that block. She come every day and talked to him. But I don't know, you know, that take you. Now this Gene Pearson up here, he's one of them fellas. He's the first cousin to Leo Sherman. Leo Sherman knows to stay drunk to kill himself. Mm. Stay drunk, finally he shot himself. And this fella up here, he's a cousin. And he gets off from Ivona desert. He gets off from her and stays out 3 or 4 days and she's gonna hunt him up. Out somewhere down drunk in the summertime in an old barn or house or something. He got over here at this old man's place. Maybe been 4 or 5 years ago, and Reuben Stewart found him over there, and he left his truck running. I think he's in the seat asleep, maybe, and the truck was still running for another year. And Reuben, he went plumb up here and hunted her up. She come down there, took 2 or 3 unloading units, beaches. They was here yesterday and she didn't leave. Mm-hmm. You couldn't take her away from me. I thought, maybe I might, but I didn't put it in place.
Thank you.
You know, it worked for me. It was hard. You know, it's hard for me. Now, I'll tell you what, you've got to put out. The thing will just screech. I could have got a job down Silver Dollar City. I hear I'm talking to you. I was over there to leave with that senior citizen's outfit sometime before these two young people come in. They had a paper in their hand. They came around where I was and I had to put an hand on the door and said, you have to be there. And she said, I'd like to get your name on this paper. I said, why? I said, we want you to come to Silver Dollar City and play the business. I said, we'll take you. We'll fix you up, fix you a suit and everything to wear, board you and everything, and give you $20 a day. Now, boarding, staying one, you wouldn't have to pay for it. Like you know, I told him then, I said, I've got a few cattle, what would they do? Some chickens. Back home. Yeah. Oh, I can't go no more. I had some good looking gal that had a beautiful car. Wouldn't be bad either,
would it? Wouldn't be too bad.
Huh?
Wouldn't be too bad.
No. I had something to eat along the road, but I wouldn't want one of that hot dogs to take a shot. High heel or what you call it. What is that you're chewing?
I ain't chewing nothing right now. How about that old skull?
Part of that stove that put that stove. Yeah. Can't do it though yet, huh?
It's a pretty bad habit.
I never did tune or smoke. And I didn't drink that whiskey, I just poured it down. And I can drink a lot of it. I never was drunk about a couple of times that drunk. But I could just drink it and the rest of the boys fall off. I could just go wrong, but a couple of times, went over here at Rock House one time, and I had a sweetheart over there, you know, kind of. And she wasn't there that night. She had a sister, and this sister was married Wes Abersine, I remember. And I thought that was my gal, I was a drunk. When she come out the door, I just hurt her with the arm. She said, hey. Well, I said, I'm thinking on going home with you. Got the wrong girl, said that was Evers' wife. I had to turn her loose. Oh, I drunk that night. But that's the silliest thing that anybody ever done. You know, the Sapellas came here back years ago and wanted to go quail hunting. All this old land back in here, I own 300 acres, and I own the funnel with the highway. I never bid it. And they came here. They wanted to, they were going to park up here, back up here, this old house, up here where these people live, and they did. And I'd go up there and take my shotgun, and they'd say, now, we'll furnish you all the shells, we want the quail. I said, I don't think I don't want to shot up there. Anyway, we go quail on and hunt all day, and we'll come down by the house here one evening, late in the evening, this Dr. Wallace was saying, Joey said, wait a minute, he said, I've got a little present I want to give you. I didn't have any idea what it was. So he went in the old shack of the house and come out and he had a fifth of whiskey. He gave it to me. That's right, Ben Brown's case I need. He gave it to me and I just stood there and looked at it, you know, and he said, you're not going to take the cap off of it now? And I said, no, I'm going to take it off now. So I just put it in my pocket, in my pocket, and put my gun on my shoulder. I come down the holler and my my missus was standing there in the door. She seen me come down. She just kept standing there. I come on up there. She kind of put the door again, and I said, Dr. Wallace, give me a tip of whiskey. And I said, I'm going to give it to you. And I just reached to her, and that whiskey's here somewhere in this house. The cat took me to the home. Floyd Dwayne was about a year old. It's been about 10 years ago. That's how much I care about the letter. I told an old drunk about that the other day. He looked at me and he said, I bet that'd be aged. He liked the bar. Give it to him, but it's here somewhere. Mom hid it someplace. It's here. I don't know what's happening. To me, the capital we took up.
Thank you. thought to play
Dusty Miller.
Yeah, but I can't play it. I'm gonna give up. I need that train. Good what I play.
Thank you. I was gonna see if I can get you to play some of your
fiddle. Oh, you can't play by yourself.
Well, I thought that sometimes the thing you look at is the end there or something.
With them eye things. With them eye things.
You know, I just love to talk. I talk too much. I get a kick out of talking, but I sat around here. He hollered, he said, "Mr. Blankenship live here?" And I said, "The old man himself, come on in." He came in, I said, "Where do you live, fella?" He said, "I live Kansas City. I'd never seen him before in life." He said, "I live Kansas City," and said, "I came all the way down here to hear you talk and hear you play the fiddle." I said, "Well, that talking will bother me." I said, "But I don't bother." So he come on in, and I sort of been talking. I didn't know he had that thing on, but he had it on. So I told him. I was born down on Pine Water where I didn't like to be, and so on and so on and so forth. So then he wanted me to play the fiddle, and I told him I didn't bother. I played the fiddle a little for him, and I said, "My grandmother came up from Tennessee before the Civil War." And I said he bought 500 acres of land down here on this creek on Bryan, $1.25 an acre. And I said he built a house down there in 84 and didn't know how to get it done, and he passed away. And I said that house is 98 years old. And I said I'd like to see the stairway in it. He said, "Let's go. You think that's the house?" So now it's been there 102 years, and I won't go back down there again. But he was a carpenter, you know, which means basically was a singing teacher and a school teacher. And I'd like to go back down and see that stairway. Of course, it's built with them old square nails. You kids never seen one of those bows. But they just like any other nail over this square. And it has a square head. I tried to drive some of them years ago. You don't see them anymore. You tear an old house down, find something, they just cast or something, you bend them, you just break off like I did. Well, I tried to drive them things, they just been bored to me. Dad, he is around here, he said, "Well, I said, I'm crossways to Grandson. But that stairway is in there, and it's just as perfect as could be, and them old doors have been hanging there all this time, they just shut perfect. The door, I look for it, level. Now that's been there, that's the oldest house, I guess, anywhere on the country. It's about 5 or 6 miles down there. I'll go down there one of these days. That stairway, he started that stairway down here. He put a tip here and one up there, and made a little landing here. Then he turned the stairway, went up and did take it there. So, them people, I told them who about who built it. So on they was old people. They come, they went in this guy, or he drove down, I didn't, I got out. There's two old people lived there. And they got out and come walking up, and I told them. But I come down there, who built the house, and so on. They was very nice when we come in. I was a light, I might have been there. Seen this house come out up there. It's a two-story building. Had a door in the gable like up there, and my mother had a brother back there way back when it come in. And Dad said he'd back in this building, you know, in the hallway up on up there, and run there and jump out and said his leg was just gonna hit the ground and run off. You thought you wouldn't. There's one used to come here, I'm talking again, I'm gonna be sure. But there's one used to come here, and he's a cousin to my mother. But he's 75, 80 years old. He looks like he's about 40 years old. Driving a nice and big left car road. He come here and stayed all night with us. That is why. And he'd just be walking along with you down the path, and just turn around and just keep walking. And I told Johnny one day, I said, he was the youngest looking old fella and the activest young guy I ever seen. Johnny said, yeah, he's not another kid. He's always get on something like that. Mother's people was all active. And this one I'm telling about the he used to come through here and there wasn't no road part of it. But it was bad. Our parish lived up here where this people lived, just as you lived where Johnny lived. This guy, he went from Georgetown County down. He'd have 8 or 10 of course, but have horses on, have it around his saddle horn, and then of course there'd be way back there and he'd stop. Of course you could get a better deal from him than anybody feeding you much more. Well, he had money, but people hard going. Get a lift on the horse, get a good horse from him. And he said he stayed all night here, but he didn't have time over that man. And he said, all right, Patty, you can trade the horse with him. Yeah, kill me when down comes. He said, I'm not going to die. But he was about the best looking guy I ever seen to be in the that's the reason one reason character's all gone good looking. She's got a little of that that church in her looking at the go for it and I don't want to go. I was and I made a pretty nice one. Don't you think so? I just about to get it.
You gotta move anyway.
I want you to take good care of her now. She lasts. Oh, she'll last 5 or 6 years. That's about right.
Yeah, you can last a little bit longer than she might take.
Yeah. Well, I was just a little different than somebody. But I've done a lot of talking. Be out with an old team, load of ties or load of lumber, going to Massey, and the wind's blowing and it's sleeting and snowing and maybe raining a little. And then check lines, while it rains on them lines, you give them a little dirt and ice and follow them lines. Be out all day that way. Come in just as wet as a dog, you had to stay right on your wagon to get there and back. Then I took a load of corn bagel one time. Of course, after I got a pretty good size, Daddy, that's easy. Harry Martin bought roast corn, and I tell you, that Martin roast corn, the big spring of the wagon, we all got a good wagon, just load that roast corn up right. He's good about helping get the horses to hook up there and take that to you. He took me to Ava, that roast corn. Anyway, out all day with that old team, took that corn off, and got back home with bachelor's mother this year. And I was just about to say, that's all we could, I'll tell you what, I was about 19, 20. We had an okay heat, so, and I was sweating the dog, and it rained a little, snowed a little, and I filled that thing full of dry wood. I mean, this fiddle is full as I could get a stick, you know, directly the pipe was red. And that old stove was just puffing and drinking that. Come in, says the house is afire. I said, what? Yeah. He said, the house is afire. They had two holes like that. And there's a burning over on the far side. Just getting fairly caught. And that stove was just pumping the cap of the rack. Got a bit of water thrown on it. You know, one of these old gals over here, they just played fish. One of them had me, one of them, what would she do with me? just listen at me talk.
Yeah, you're talking about the same talk.
You have to.
I can do it, but...
Yeah.
Morning, I got up. And I cooked me a pound of biscuits, 10. Fried just good meat, 4 or 5 eggs, about 10 o'clock.
Yeah.
You have to be.
You know, I'm a kind of halfway look at the Waldo Burke over here, Daddy's band. I play with them. They're going to come. I'm about out of fiddles. I've only got 13.
Is that all?
13 fiddles. Got a mound in there. I don't know. Fiddle case. John. $1, so I can go to town in the morning. I could go to town, I had $2. I could go to town, now you can get 2 eggs, a little bowl of gravy, and a biscuit for $1. I don't know what I know about that. I need $3. One to ride, one to eat breakfast, and then one to go down there. Good. If I had $3, I could get right today. Johnny, he don't like me call that, but Mr. Old, he don't like it, but I don't let him get right. You've been across the hill, haven't you, Karen?
Yeah.
That thing goes right across the hill, don't complain a bit, just goes right on across. You come here, sometimes it'll have 4 or 5 picked up. It'll just pick them up from the road here and there somewhere else. But they go right across the hill there. Once in a while, it goes around down the Johnny's, but it's 5 miles around over here. It's just 3/4 mile across the hill. Got a woman driver part of the time. She can sound about band things. I talk to her. You know, we had a school teacher. I'm going to tell you, I'll hear somebody else talk about this. Years and years ago, I was on the school board. I was on the school board for many, many years. And I was down there in the field full of notes. Here comes a school teacher up there. She got out. She said she's looking for school. She said the school's been let here yet. She said, I'd like to put my application in. He said, I believe you're too young to be a school teacher. She said, thank you, no. Well, I said, you sound a good test in school. I knew she'd get it. She told me she loved you. Old Uncle Gum Roper's granddaughter. I told her pretty soon. I said, well, if you get him, don't you go to my doctor. You come back at certain times without board school. I know she would. Yeah, but what you think? Well, I said, I think it's better hard. So we did. And she boarded up here with her sister up here with the nuns, didn't she? That little old Johnny Dodson, they lived up there in that next old house. And, oh, he's about 6 or 7 years old. And he come down there and had a foot log in up there across the street. He come down there and she helped the little fella across the street come on down there. One morning it was just sleeping and snowing and the floor, and I bet his knees old. We lived up there in that old shack of a house, I think, about 6 feet. Yeah, she came, you know, and that's the coolest person I ever seen. She's just as wet as a dog, and she fell off that foot log, and that little boy, he fell in, lost his dinner bucket, and his boy stole down the creek, and she told him the best thing he could do is go back up to the house. We went from home. He said, could you go back up there to my sister and get me a change of clothes? And I said, yeah, I will. I had some horses in for that car. I went and got a horse, and I'll tell you, boy, that was about 4 times I came. Went up there and had one of them sacked up, a great sack of stuff, and I brought it down there and changed clothes. I seen her not too long ago. And this gal that drives this bus here, she said she knew her well. She's a good now. But now that is the wettest thing you've ever seen. Her clothes were froze on her. Of course, that old creek, I don't know. I bet it's that deep. Oh, it's good long, but I don't remember whether it's ice on the log or whether they just fell off. I don't know. That little boy, she got him out somewhere. She brought him a new dinner bucket. That was about the coldest for my thing in the wedding. She's a one of them walkers girl down there at that trail car out. I went down there. Oh, about 15 years ago. Now, Karen, I'm going to turn the phone over to you and tell you.
What do you
want to
hear?
Well, something good, no matter what you
hear.
These other
brothers
don't know. Oh,
the sucker.
No, you know, believe it or not, maybe something's happened here. I'm not telling you, but people's names, I can tell kids I went to this fellow lives down below way with Johnson. I don't remember his given name, but he called me every day or two. And yesterday I sat down here and talked to him. Telephone. Talked a little while. He began to tell me who all he was acquainted with around Ava. He said, I used to carry the mail, he said, to the Grover Mark T. He said, did you know Bill Bergen? I said, oh, yeah, I do. That's Bunk's brother. You know, Dorothy goes on that bus once in a while.
Never seen her in a while. I haven't seen that Dorothy in a long
time. You don't even let me put my arm around her. Well, I didn't ask. Maybe that was the reason.
Maybe that was it.
I couldn't be. Yeah, you know, there's some way I live all alone. And I get up when I get ready, and I do as I please. I don't need to do now, you know, the light bill used to come due every month. Now it comes due every 2 weeks. And so we tell them, I'm trying not to do again. Seemingly, about 2 weeks. And it gets higher all the time.
Yeah.
It does, but it does that. It's higher. The telephone is going to raise them up another 5 bucks. I'll have to just go cheer up. Dad said, my dad was a great guy. He's always been on straight on that time. He's made a ball bat and it sits in the back room and it's just as perfect as it. Did you see, Karen? It's just as perfect as a factory made. Around. He come in here and he sit right there and scrape the shape of me right there on the floor. He just dusty sent all off the box. She brought him on. She said, get a dustpan, a broom, she clean up his mess. We'd go outside, talk around a little bit, drink, he'd come back, he'd be a craving again. I don't like it. And I owned a 40 acre of land over here. I still owned it, had an old house on it. And he decided he'd move on my old house. So he went down there to Stevens and bought him a bookstore. That was pretty well fixed up. He didn't ask me if it was all right to move in the house, what it was. But anyway, he moved up there, that old house. He went over there and cut him some wood. It's pretty dear, Ken. He came over here and he said he wanted me to come over there and haul his wood in so he could get wood saw pulled, so he could get wood saw, and I did. And got in around the stove, all shaped about that deep all around the stove. And I said, we'd ought to get the house fire all that shaved around before the fire goes out. I said, I would sweep them up, but said they're good and tough. I just laid out all my, just laid down the shape. Wasn't that something? I'll tell another noise and I won't tell that another. I had a little boy and he'd built a new house over here. He's going to Rock Ridge to get a little lumber. Finished lumber. Of course, I'm not going. Hooked up the team, took the wagon bed off. Took all day to go down there to 20, 25 miles down there. Got down there about night. He bought his lumber and loaded it up. He's on the biggest bringer on the outside of the store. And he asked the customer, said, wouldn't it be all right to tie them, water my horses, and feed them, tie them around there, and then trees down there, and then water them. He said, this man, John Edwards, he said, would be all right for me and this little boy to sleep in your sheep on top of the night. Now, you know where they played that lumber? Well, I bet them shavings were that deep. We had some old pumpkins and stuff. It was a good bed just when I was slept in a planer and it was a clean pumpkin. I think about all the next morning, then I put it in. Eat a little by. I believe we cooked a little on the fire. What if some lad had to make a trip like that? But it was nice weather that time. What if it had been a rain or snow? It'd just been the same thing. You'd have to go that old team right along. I have walked right along to the front wheel that just poured in the rain and the water running down. Water squishing out of my shoes, driving my team in. People now, they'll talk about hard time getting the car on the heat. Now, that's true. That's just the difference. Back then, you could get nickel for a lot of boys, my age back in there, worked 8 cents a day. But I never did work for 8 cents a day. I was all of my business. That old girl over there, Peter, said they'd just run in the hill there. Never was sick. Well, I've not been sick the last 2 years. And I just went right on. And if I could walk, I could go right on now. I want to get out here and get around so bad, and I can't do that. I take this old chair out here and sit out here and split wood. I get tired, I'll split a few blocks, and I'll set this chair. But I can't cook. I can't cook what I want. I'll just cook what I've got. I know it. why that Jackie don't come down once in a while. I talk to him a lot before he comes. He's like a dad. He doesn't pay no attention. One time, I used to get mad at Floyd because he couldn't talk. One time, you know, he's always a good driver, and if we had an old truck, the old truck just that way. We had gone down the road here one morning. I was doing this rattling, I don't know what I was telling him. Something he didn't hear. Got away out down there and he still hadn't said a word. Oh, he just gunned that truck right on, you know, down the road directly. I looked around at him and said, I don't hear what you talking about. And then I swelled up and I said, there's no word. We went on to Mansfield and he never said a word somewhere on the Mansfield or I never even. And said a word. Now, careful, we'd be that if you talk to your lips, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
I was looking around here the other day, and I found Mother's picture here. And now that's an old one.
Where's that?
It's there in that Bible. Hold on, let me tell one of those. I'm going to lose my left and left one, but you're going to look right there, take your old book off the top. But her picture's in there, and I know it's been taken over 90 years ago. Just flipped through there. You fight it with them long skirts on, dragging the ground.
There's one of Jackie Loretta.
Oh, yeah.
One of you.
Yeah. Well, her picture's there somewhere. I sure don't want to get lost.
Still 49 and 50.
About 2 inches wide, about 5 inches long. And I know it's been taken over 90 years.
Is your horse?
Now that white, that was the best horse I'd ever seen, Eva. Yes, sir. Yeah, that's my horse.
Is that you are?
There you've been. Now, but you heard that, and I didn't. Now, I'll tell you what, that was the best horse. There's a gal over there that knows about my horse. She's old. I told her the other day, I said, if we had that horse, we'd just leave this part. But she said, we sure would. I told her, I said, I bet that horse would bring $1,000 now if he's alive like he was then. Said he told her about 100. Did you find that picture?
No, I
think it's the same
picture.
I've got my saddle hanging in there. My saddle's hanging in there. Right? You know, Bill Everett fell over here on that horse and lived over here about 4 or 5 miles. And he rode that horse to Springfield one day and back. I got 4 gallon whiskey.
Is there?
Yes, sir. He rode him to Springfield back. Went to the Sparta, I think.
What kind of horse was it?
He was a gray horse. And he had them long hair, but he's the neatest thing you ever saw, and he was a show horse.
Yeah.
He'd been in a show, and he killed his master. And Leo Gates bought him out of school in Norwood. Dick, Tom, and Harry owned him here, and he strode everybody that ever owned him, including me.
Yeah.
He's a nervy fella. If you didn't know how to get on him, you couldn't get on him at all.
Yeah.
So they had to pull his head around again in your knee to get on him.
There's a driver's license for that
1943.
Driver's license for
43.
Yes,
it's
Floyd Blankenship.
Oh, I'm not old enough.
White male.
Black
hair. Gray eyes.
Wait, 170, did you say?
Yep, 170.
Too much speed. You never did find that picture?
No, yeah, I'm looking too much other stuff.
How old's that saddle?
Well, it's made 1915 in Los Angeles, California. And it's a handmade saddle. And it hung out here in this building while I got uneasy about seeing somebody steal it. And I went and got it. Somebody else told me in this back room up there with it. And that's worth $500, so. Maybe more. It's got a silver horn.
This it?
No, that's hard for
me. Two people.
Now that's mother. That miss. That's her. She's pretty, nearly as pretty as Karen. Now that's been taken over 90 years, I know. But
who is this?
Oh, hard work. That old Lansdowne girl. I didn't hear much about her. But that's her picture. That brown one.
Yeah, that's a picture in here.
Do I know?
You got all kinds of pictures in here.
When
you playing the fiddle?
Or, you go to any mother picture. Mm-hmm. I know that's been taken over 90 years. Them long dress tails they wore then that swept the grass. She was a pretty one in that sweet and carrots. She's doggone good with one reason. Mm-hmm. Well, she don't take care of me, but she don't talk. So hadn't that picture stood up good to be took that long?
Yeah.
See, she'd been dead in about a year. Long time. No, that saddle. The cattle eat the lining out of it, you know, get the balls. And I carried it around a bit. It hadn't been on the horse. But I loaned it to that broke boy here. Oh, he broke it down the road. Lord of rest. Nobody know who that is. Them nuns are just quicking around out there talking to me. I'd have run that day if I'd had any chance. But I was sitting out there, no shirt on, man, it was hot. They kept there all pretty deaf. If I'd have knew they'd come, I'd have been gone. But I didn't know they'd come away. One time out there, I can talk all day and tell my experience. Long years ago, this bunch of us boys got some horse on the kind of whiskey peach. And we was a horseback, and we rolled and rolled up in a riding slicker. We caught that from my saddle, and once a while we stopped going to Brown's Cave, and we stopped to take a little drink of our liquor, you know. So we went down there, they had a dance floor. I played the fiddle some, and finally he played some. We drank up all the whiskey we had. And Guy Lakey, now he's still living, he's a good age, so he come down, he knew he's crazy. He was laying whiskey, so we all chipped in and bought a quart of whiskey. So we went up and brought the cave, drank a little bit, passed one and five, six. We went back down there to dance floor, danced a little place to get a little boy. Cattle Bard, he come there from Haven, he got up on dance floor, he said, well, get me along right back. Well, that time it was about 11 o'clock, so the dance floor was up. So we went down there in that buckwheat patch and took a ride and took us off. They just passed down that sandbar and laid down after 6 hours. Next morning, my horse is down there, that good horse. hadn't had a bite to eat, you know, or drink the water since the morning before. He said, I didn't go to a place and let him eat just pour him one foot and the other, eat him on the floor, of course. So it was along about 9, 10 o'clock, the sun was shining over Sand Ridge. I had never got sick. Man, I was drunk as it could be, and I got up on my elbow. Rest of it all was up, but a picnic. He had an end to the picnic about 10 o'clock, and then the lady was coming in there. I thought, well, this fool down there had some corn, made his hay, and I thought, well, I'll get up before I walk down there to get a horse and corn. Feed him, and I'll go up there and get me a hamburger, and I'll go home. So I went down there and got 5 or 6 stalks of corn, a little bunch of them, and hay brought up there and cooked up. Paul, I had a good deep nerve by that. It's just Paul, you know, personally putting the other. So I went up to picnic ground, got me a hamburger for a dime, a cup of coffee for a nickel, and still wasn't traveling too good. I went down there and I tied that good over. The creek had just run bright, just run right along there. Not pretty good. I thought, now, I got him up there in that water and showed him a dollar to drink. Rode him out there in the water and he's just rooting that water to Paul. He said, Paul, I'm just rooting that water like that. Wouldn't drink a drop. I started home up about 27 miles. I got down that little creek. Well, I come by and seen my gal, Gladys. Mm-hmm. She said, anyway, I come by there. I know she knows that about dead, but I didn't tell her about my experience. But I stopped with her just a little bit when I got on that good horse, told him about that little creek field night. I bet he drank it up for a while. Now, that horse knew there's something wrong with him, and he's taking me home. There's no question. I thought about that many times, but he did. He wasn't eating it for a drink. He got close for me. Come on up. Dad's a bachelor, of course. Dad said, sure glad you got in. Don't let the dog free. You never run out of employment.